for sale. Appetizing young love for sale. Driver man, he made a life, but the mammy ain't his wife. Chopping cotton, don't be slow. Better finish out your row. Keep a moving with that plow. Driver man will show you how. Get to work and root that stump. Driver man will make you jump. Better make your hammer ring. Driver man will start to swing. Ain't but two things on my mind. Driver man and quitting time. Driver man, they kind of boss. Ride a man and lead a horse. When his cat o' nine tail fly, you'd be happy just to die. Run away and you'll be found by his big old red bone hound. Patty roll up, bring you back, make you sorry you is black. Drive a man, he made a life, but the mammy ain't his wife. Ain't but two things on my mind. Drive a man and quitting time. Thank you.
Good evening. And welcome to volume 5 of Tap History Nights. How is everyone doing? Thanks for joining again. Lovely to see some familiar faces. This is Abby Lincoln with Max Watt. From something called The Freedom Suite, a wonderful album as well. I found this video a few years ago, and it's heavy, but very much within our realm of things we'll be discussing this evening. Our theme being early tap dance, or tap dance before tap dance was tap dance. And there will be some guessing involved, and I can't promise this will all be historically accurate in the slightest, but it's what I can gauge to the best of my abilities from reading various sources and doing a little bit of research, but I'm definitely not a historian by any means. So again, please take what I say with a grain of salt. But yes, this is brought to you by 1929 Studios and the beautiful Ramona Staffeld, who may join us a little bit later. We'll see how we go. And oh, it's okay, Olga. Do not worry. I've been looking forward to this one, actually. It was my thought maybe I should say where we are. First of all, I've gone on a bit of a journey again in these COVID times. And this is actually the New York Public Library standing behind me around 1920 or so. There's some time travel involved, and it's a wintry day. I'm very inappropriately dressed. But I like this painting. It's actually by a Czech artist. I like it very much. But so early dancing. I started to get very curious about this as I delved into blues music a couple of years ago. And since then, I've not listened to anything else. And it really blew my mind. And I started to discover some things I felt like for myself that kind of led me to start exploring kind of where some of these movements that we use in our everyday tap dance language might have arrived from. And there's been a handful of people who've talked about this. Marshall Stearns, who wrote this wonderful book, Jazz Dance and American Jazz Vernacular, along with his wife, I believe, Jean Stearns. And he was the first to write a history book on tap dancing in the 60s at some point. But he was very into different kinds of folk dances of all denominations, and was very analytical with a lot of this, which is definitely not my mindset, but it's intriguing, to say the least, to look at different styles and qualities of movement and kind of imagine how it may have led to what's considered now modern day tap dance vernacular, which has changed hugely, but there's still some things that sneak in there from who knows how long ago, 150 years, 200 years maybe, from its murky beginnings. So with that being said, please once again use the chat as much as you like. It's wonderful to hear from you. And these wonderful celebratory emojis. And if you do have a question, please shout out. It's just nice we keep them muted while the videos are playing, because then things get complicated. But I think that's all. Did everyone have a good Christmas and New Year's and things? Nice one. Here it's hot actually today. I'm in Melbourne. Cleverly disguised as New York. It's deceiving, but yes, it's been very warm. With that, let us dive in. There's lots, and I don't know how far we're going to get, actually. I'm a little bit worried, but we try our best to see. So I think we begin here. One, and we've probably brushed on multiple things of this in various times, perhaps. So there may be stuff that's not so new for us, or some that maybe is, but nice to talk about anywho. And I'd like to begin with New Orleans, because this is actually a very important place in the scope of jazz, which is, I think, a huge umbrella term for also this dancing. Tap dance being one of them is a jazz dance. And New Orleans, in the early days of settlement in America, I mean, at some point in the 1700s, perhaps maybe early 1800s, it became a very bustling port and a very much a traffic crossing for people from Europe. A lot of French people were arriving, a lot of people from Spain, as well as black slaves who were also living in New Orleans. But hugely diverse, I think, more so than other cities at the same time in the United States. But what was also interesting, it was slightly, a little bit more free in terms of cultural crossings, which did not happen. Well, I'm sure it did happen in other places, but it was not allowed to be talked about, I'd say. Whereas in New Orleans, there was some sort of understanding that a lot of crossovers did happen. And a big part of this was the Creole culture, which was people who were considered not white or black, but a caste in between, a similar thing that, happens in countries all over the world. But they were given a little bit more rights in the city, in New Orleans. But other things that I didn't know, like even in brothels, normally they were, I'm sure, quite segregated. But weirdly, in New Orleans, there was no race barrier between black or white, which was very, very unusual in 1800s. But there was a lot of musical traditions arriving in this place all at once. A lot from Ireland, a lot from England, and huge amounts from places all over Africa, which is hugely rich in many different kinds of cultures. And at least the story goes, there was a place called Congo Square where people would gather every Sunday morning, because this was often people's days off, and also it was the day off that slaves could be free to play music. And in New Orleans, they were actually allowed to play drums, which was not allowed for some time in many other parts of the states, which we'll maybe get to later. But Congo Square, there's, maybe I've mentioned before, there's a wonderful book by Sidney Bechet called Treat It Gentle, and he describes his grandfather, Omar, who was a beautiful drummer, and he'd be the first to arrive at this square Sunday morning, and people would know it was Sunday because they'd hear Omar's drum from the square playing, calling out to them, and people would run out from their houses and go to the square and get ready for a huge Sunday party. And it's kind of hard to imagine what was going on, but I'm sure there was a lot of different kinds of dances and from all traditions, but definitely a lot of hand drumming, probably djembe, duns, maybe even timbale, this kind of thing, who knows. String instruments, brass instruments were huge. And of course, a lot of improvisation, because this was a music about communication and talking to one another using music and dance. But yes, I found this video that maybe watch now. It's actually, it's from the 1960s, but it's a video of a funeral parade that happened in New Orleans, which was quite a special occasion, as you'll see, because often it would happen that one person would, there'd be a band organized, I'd say, but it would be a funeral march and turned into a parade and then a party. And many people in the city would be out celebrating this person's life. And it's super beautiful. So we're going to start with this one, I think.
The tradition of music at funerals is widespread. In African cultures, a dirge is performed on the way to the final resting place of the deceased. ¶¶
cemetery, we strike up what we consider a lively number to make the people forget their griefs and their sorrows and take the mind off of what has just happened. They just enjoy that music, and the beat attracts them. You can hear that band, the thudding of the drums, 3 and 4 blocks away sometimes.
Many of the great New Orleans jazz musicians started by playing on the streets in funeral parades.
That was New Orleans. Sorry for the very cheesy narration that's in that video, but I just wanted to give us a bit of contextual flavor, perhaps, as what New Orleans may have looked like, because I'm sure it's changed a lot, but this tradition of music and dance there is very, very strong. And I went maybe 4 or 5 years ago to New Orleans, and still you see parades happen like this. Someone will just start playing and neighborhoods gather and it turns into a huge party, which is amazing. And it blows my mind thinking if I'd grown up in such a culture as this, with just people around you dancing, I think that would have been lovely. But yes, I make do. That was New Orleans. A lot of the older tap dancers, who we consider the elders now, many of whom are no longer living, but a lot of them started dancing on the streets. I'd say nearly all of them, very few were trained in dance schools. And having tap plates on the shoes actually came quite a bit later. And before that, people were dancing very often just regular shoes, which were usually leather soled, so they make a bit of a sound. But it became quite trendy to put bottle caps on the bottom of your shoes. You just kind of like hammer them on, or sometimes with nails, I guess. And this went on for a long time. And actually now still in New Orleans, you see children dancing on the street, but they use usually Coke cans, and they'll squash them and use glue or put a nail in the bottom of their sneakers. And they're doing the same thing as was happening probably 200 years ago, which is wild to see. At least now though, it's more than a little bit shady. And I'm not sure, but I very much got the feeling that it's a bit of an institution. There could be a slightly older big brother or someone watching these children on the corner taking their money for the day to make sure everything's gone smoothly. It's there was something a bit strange to see, but exciting nonetheless, because a lot of these rhythms haven't changed all that much. Only now they're dancing off in some like hip hop beats, usually with this clap going on. So I found a video actually of just a few years ago of some children in New Orleans with the Coke can. So let's check this out so you have an idea. Unfortunately, there's none with bottle caps, but here is a contemporary equivalent.
The bottom of those shoes. These Coke cans? Pretty awesome.
Look,
just to give us some idea. I love this clap too. Classic rhythm down in New Orleans. Yeah, I find this so interesting to imagine. I think it's changed a lot, definitely. Like now it's probably more a means of making money, I'd say, more than anything. Not that this was not the case 100 years ago in cities all over America. There were many, many dancers dancing on the street, but I think then there was also the want to learn more, and it was very competitive and I think artistic in a way. It was like having playing music together, or people would play off of each other. And there's stories of some of the older tap dancers in, there was a handful of cities where they were especially competitive, and certain street corners might be more advanced than others. So if you were just beginning to tap dance, you would start on one corner and slowly progress your way up if you could hang with the people on the next corner. And you'd probably know if you were not welcome. But this is, it goes way, way back in tap dance. It was always, and I think in jazz music too, it was quite competitive, but in a very friendly way. Yes, New Orleans. Well, what else? There's, I found this other video recently. I've been very into watching different kinds of African dancers from all over, but I especially like West Africa. I don't know why something about it especially, but this one I think will be nice because especially in New Orleans, there were many people from West Africa in countries such as Senegal or Mali, all kinds of Ivory Coast, Ghana, Nigeria. And a strong tradition from these places probably led to some voodoo tradition, which is also still popular in New Orleans and runs quite deeply inside of the city, I think. But at least people believe this came from probably several cultures, but one huge one was called the Yoruba people. And they were from the west coast of Africa and probably spanned many countries. But an old, old, old tradition. I'm sure many songs, dances, stories, gods that they celebrated. But I started reading about this and became particularly interested as well because they very much respected the women. And it was the women elders especially were considered magic. If they lived to be an old age, they were practically good witches. But they were respected for their skill in trading, for their craftsmanship, and for their ability to deal in business and things like this. Which I just love because it seems unusual in some other cultures. But this particular video we're going to watch is from a celebration that they do once a year at the least, probably on several occasions, but it's a masquerade, and they make these very beautiful masks to celebrate womanhood and being a mother and all these things that this entails. But it led to some pretty wild dancing, and it's actually the men dancing with the mask on and kind of over-accentuating what was considered female characteristics. And it's very rhythmic. You'll see them dancing flat-footed, doing all kinds of different sounds. But I think the reason I find this interesting is because I think it's a lot of the syncopations of the way they use rhythm has carried over into tap dance and jazz especially. And I think we still use a lot of this stuff, but it's very complex in this music, but it's just wild to see. So I hope you enjoy. This is, it's actually called a Gelede masquerade. And this is in Nigeria. So check it out. Hello. The Gelede masquerade of the Yoruba people, which again was all this west coast of Africa. I love this. It blew my mind seeing this video. Who knows? I mean, I can't say this came from this, but I find it funny to imagine the kind of different cultures that were really intermingling and crossing over in places such as New Orleans, which had just such old musical and dance traditions that I don't even know if they're considered musical and dance traditions separately like this. I believe in a lot of these older cultures, they were one, and they were really inseparable. But yeah, a lot of big melting pot, cultural melting pot all over the States, I think, in its early foundational years, which led to, well, all kinds of things. Led to President Trump this year, last year. But some nice things as well. Yes. Well, that was New Orleans, and which again, I think, compared to a lot of other places in the United States at the same period, we're talking mid-1800s, was a lot freer in its policy regarding like interaction between different races. Other places, I think quite quickly, they actually banned drumming of all kinds of slaves playing. And I don't know if there was a definitive date, but at least one story was that there was a rebellion, maybe the biggest at the time, that was called the Stoner Rebellion. And this happened in maybe Georgia, somewhere in the south of North America. And in, I want to say 18, no, earlier, 17, sorry, I have it somewhere, 1739. Yes, quite a while. But a man led a group of like 20 slaves. They left their plantation where they were working, and they started to march, and they took with them some drums, I believe, and they robbed a store close by and took some weapons and things and marched quite a long distance, slowly gathering more slaves from other plantations, convincing people to join them. They ended up with about 80 people. And then white folks from around organized kind of like a vigilante army of sorts of maybe 150 men, or maybe it was much more, and came and a small battle kind of happened, and the slaves actually did very well for the numbers, but the rebellion was put down. A lot were executed immediately. Others, some escaped for a time and were later caught. But this kind of led to, over the following years, some tightening of already kind of not so nice restrictions and things of how slaves were being treated and living. But this became, it was put on paper, certain regulations, like they had to have one white person for every 10 black people, I believe, on a plantation for security reasons. They were not allowed to educate slaves at all, and slaves were no longer allowed to grow their own food. So they were completely reliant upon the slave master, driver man, as we saw in the opening with Abby Lincoln. So yes, these were not nice times for slaves, for black people in particular. And yes, there was a clause soon after as well regarding drumming, and they decided to ban it in most areas, I believe, of the United States, because again, no one really knows. I think they thought people could communicate with these drums and kind of organize rebellions such as these, which may or may not have been true, but it is very much the case in a lot of countries in Africa that people are able to just about speak with their drums. I don't know how articulately, I imagine it's like poetry when they're playing, and sometimes you hear very distinct little phrases that people hear it and they know what is coming or what's expected. So there may be some truth in this. Also, I believe it was quite a religious thing as well, because there were a lot of, I want to say, Baptist church people. I forget which. There's one, maybe someone knows, Protestant? No, there's one that really did not like dancing or music, and it unfortunately in the South kind of took hold. It was really popular, so they just like outlawed dancing and playing except on certain days. But yes, the drum especially was seen as a bit exotic and risque, and I mean it was not in the white pantheon of music at all. So they, well, sad, no more drumming. But soon after this, then, of course, things started to change because people need an outlet for frustration and all the pain they were feeling, which would have been absolutely horrible. And there has to be a way to do this. And often, I mean, they were given one day off usually. And this would have been the music-making day once upon a time, or I don't know, you could grow your food until that was not allowed. Or I'm sure just rest, but it was very popular to be dancing together. And so when drums were outlawed, suddenly people had to kind of make their own instruments, or I'd say the dancing changed as well, which is when we hear about things such as patting juba, which was apparently when you stand around clapping like this. And someone will come in the middle of maybe you're standing in a circle, and dance a little bit of this. It's patting juba, all on parts of the body as well. And different forms of this dance. There was another one called a ring shout, where people would also stand in the circle, clapping with tambourine, singing song. And there were probably kind of specific movements that went with these things, or I'd say it became a game of sorts, or a ritual, or just a way of expression, but would have very quickly found a form that became kind of solid. I mean, you're with the same group of people for quite a time, perhaps. It would have been very, very slow to change. So let's watch. This is a video of a dance called the Buzzard Lope, which became popular much later in time. And this is actually a recreation with a group called the Georgia Sea Island Dancers in maybe the 1950s, I don't know. But to me, it has this ring that it could have been much earlier, 150 years earlier even, the way they're moving and singing. And this became a popular dance to do at parties as well, the Buzzard Lope. But you'll see there's a man being a buzzard or a vulture as he's dancing, and there's a white cloth in the center of the circle as the people are singing. And this cloth is meant to be someone who's died in the field and hasn't been buried. So they kind of could be celebrating their life, mourning them, all of these things. But it's a very, very beautiful dance. And if you notice his feet as he's dancing, there's some interesting things going on there also. So let's check it out.
Go to the wool cart.
Throw me anywhere, Lord,
in that old field.
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 Don't care where you throw me,
in that old field.
Let's change people throw me,
in that old field.
Don't care how you throw me,
in that old field.
That was the Buzzard Lope with the Georgia Sea Island Singers. Absolutely love this. Oy, oy, oy. And somehow it's how I imagine some very, very early form of tap dance would have looked, which really was not tap dance. There were many dance forms like this that had some kind of shape to them, maybe a series of steps that everyone knew, but knew them as shapes. Like, it was all often quite flexible, as you would if you're playing bluegrass music or jazz. You have these riffs or licks that become kind of the standard vocabulary and are quite malleable, and you can have a bit of a play with this. So I imagine this is something similar was probably going on with the Buzzard Lop. Beautiful to see as well. There's one dancer I should mention who became very, very famous around the 1840s, and his name was William Henry Lane, aka the King of All Dancers, as he was then billed, and just became hugely popular. He was a black man who was born free, we think, in New York, and was also caught off in Master Juba, and this happened after a challenge dance he had with another dancer who was quite well known at the time, whose name was John Wiggins. He was an Irish minstrel dancer, a white dancer, and minstrelsy was coming up, I'd say, around the same time. Yes, I don't know if we've probably mentioned it before, but medicine shows probably maybe predated this a little bit, but it was a very popular form of entertainment in, I'd say, the early 1800s, perhaps. And these were shows when people would go from town to town, often a doctor, sometimes credible, sometimes not, selling bottles of snake oil or miracle cure all in these different towns. But it was an excuse to set up a tent and have a carnival of sorts, essentially. And people would come and see comedians, you'd see dancers, musicians play, all kinds of things. But this all came about from someone selling their special magic brew. But they'd take groups of people with them on these tours to attract a crowd and hopefully make some money. Out of this, maybe grew minstrelsy, which really began as white people were imitating the way black people were singing, dancing, and entertaining. And it's hard to tell what it was exactly. It was definitely a form of mockery. It was part like poking, huge and horrible stereotypes in the whole format. Some different characters became very popular. I don't even remember their names, but it's where almost like a pantomime or this Italian, does anyone know the name of this? The theater dell'arte or something. You know, we have the one with the long nose, and you have the one who's like very energetic and jumps around. It became like this, but minstrelsy, and they had their own characters of sorts that had often, you might have the black man who thinks is very dapper and elegant, but really is very stupid, and everyone knows this except him. Or you have the mammy who's big and motherly, and everyone loves her. And it's hard to imagine just how popular this form of entertainment was, but it was in a time way before even radio. So the only way you could see anything was live, and that probably on rare occasions. Because, I mean, they were traveling with horses and carts to get to the next place. So, I mean, people were hanging out to see stuff when it came to their town. And it was talked about probably, and everyone's waiting for the next one. But this stuff really, I believe, got just embedded into American culture and is still there. You see with modern day comedians, knowingly, hopefully, well, many I think unknowingly also use these traditions. In the expressions they use, there's a thing called mugging, where you like do these big eyes and smiles, like as a way to make people laugh, or as a tool, an entertainment tool. But this originated in minstrelsy as white people making fun of other black artists, exaggerating features. So yeah, I don't know. It's if you'd like to read about this, please do. I'd strongly recommend it, but it's be ready, because there's some dark things in there. But it really stuck around for a long time. And why was I saying all of this? Minstrelsy. William Henry Lane was around at this time, but he was not involved with minstrelsy, but apparently had a huge influence on that. Like, he almost became a character within minstrel circuits after his lifetime, because he was so well known. And he's the handful of tap history books there are, he's often credited as like the first famous tap dancer, or the first tap dancer even, because what he was doing was not, tap dance was not called this, they'd call him a jig dancer. But there was a lot of traditional English and Irish dances going on, which also I don't think exist anymore, because the Irish dance we see today has been standardized since a long time ago, and it's taught by dancing masters and given a form which it did not originally have. It used to be a dance that people just did together in the bars hanging out. So I don't believe it had this these lines, and maybe even not stationary arms. That might be a recent phenomenon. I could be wrong. But there was a lot of this going on and was very popular, but mingling a lot with many different traditions of African dance as well. But I'd say, who knows how long it took, but quite quickly it probably lost its distinction between different styles and just would have started to meld into something new. And dance challenges also went back since the beginning of time with this. And anyway, this one with William Henry Lane, aka the king of all dances, was, he had a challenge with this John Wiggins, and they danced for many hours in a bar, going backwards and forwards and treading steps and going faster and slower and faster and slower. And then he was apparently crowned the victor. And from this, he's like became even more famous because John Wiggins was very well known as a white minstrel performer. So then William Henry Lane started traveling, and he went to Europe as quite a young man and was doing shows like crazy, probably like hundreds a week, at least was the story. And soon after, he died of exhaustion from just, who knows what, not eating properly or just being worked too hard. But he was quite young. But his name survived and lived on, which is even more impressive, seeing as there was not such a way to record any of this stuff besides written accounts. And considering he was a black man, it's especially impressive, because white critics, of course, were loath to write about black artists. And the highest compliment they get paid often was that they danced very exotically with grotesque shapes and can dance like no one's business. But just this weird messed up vocabulary that they're just trying to say, well, they were really good. They just didn't know how to say it. Yeah, but that's William Henry Lane. There's a wonderful portrait of him, but who knows what his dancing looked like, because it really would have been a mix of stuff. There's been some weird recreations I've seen on YouTube lately, but I wouldn't trust these, perhaps. So what else? I wanted to show one of a favorite dancer of mine called Chuck Green, who we've seen before, who's very much a tap dancer for tap dancers, and for quite a long period was, I think, looked up to by a lot of dancers, young and old. He was a protege of Buck and Bubbles for many years here with the duo. He was Chuck and Chuckles. They were the children counterparts and did the act of Buck and Bubbles, but in miniature. And later went on for a little while with Chuckles, but then maybe the war happened or something and they split, and Chuck had a very hard time for many, many years, but just incredible dancer. And I don't know why, but seeing this video of the Buzzard Log, I immediately think of Chuck Green. So I just like to share this. We can go with the strange hunch of mine, but I think it's the way he holds his center and stays close to the ground, and even the way he uses his feet. We'll see. But please enjoy. This is one of my most favorite videos of Chuck. This is the 1979 in France. Here we go. Thank you. Yeah, the more I watch his dancing, the more I realize just how difficult what he's doing is. And it's so clean, so clean. Kind of hard to tell from these kind of videos unless you watch it really, really closely. But yeah, boy, beautiful dancer. He was still very enigmatic, actually, to me. I really wish I could have met him. There's a few short interviews on these two documentaries, No Maps of My Taps and About Tap, which are wonderful. You'll get to see him speak a little bit. And he has many memorable things to say. Yes. In this, I believe he says, you can't always do what you want to do. You've got to do what's needed. And this is the way he dances, very much quite reserved, gives you just enough in the moment. Yeah. So good. Well, there's one other dancer I'd like to mention too, who there's also just no record of besides stories, but he was very well known at the time also. His name was King Rastus Brown. And he was probably one of the most well-known buck and wing dancers, which was kind of what this style started to become known as in some point in the late 1800s, this like mix of things. But it probably came again from a few specific steps, one being the wing, maybe we're saying and buck dancing, but probably a handful of different time steps. But he became very famous in the minstrel circuits, and everyone knew King Rastus Brown, and he was quite competitive also, and apparently had a thing for Bill Robinson and would challenge him publicly often, but Bill never arrived at one of these challenges. Said he was busy, which is interesting. But yeah, I mean, there's no drawings or anything, but they say he always had like a big long cigar in his mouth. He'd have a derby hat on, had these spats on his shoes, and he had this long coat that he always put medals on for some reason, and would hang out quite often at the Hoofers Club. And I think some of the early Hoofers would have learned from him. Some of the younger guys, like Eddie Rector, definitely. Maybe Dobby Wilson, some of these guys. But it's all stories, who knows? I find him interesting, King Rastus Brown. And in another video with Baby Lawrence, a great documentary, which I probably mentioned, called The Jazz Hoofer, Baby Lawrence. He's giving a little demonstration in front of an audience somewhere, and he's talking a little bit about some developments in tap dance. And he mentions King Rastus Brown having the idea of putting tap plates on the shoes. I don't know whether this is true or not, but I haven't heard any other thing, so it could be. Before that, again, it was just regular leather-soled shoes or bottle caps on your shoes, and that was it. But also, there wasn't amplified music for a long time, which is probably strange to imagine as well. So the general volume of live entertainment was much quieter, unless you're dancing with brass instruments. But I think they would have been very aware of the sound and giving dancers space as well, because it was such a popular way of dancing. And I'd say most of these early musicians were dancers, and most dancers were musicians. It was a huge crossover. But so we've seen the buzzard log, as a form of dance. The buck and wing we're talking about now, but there was many other kind of dance forms, we can say, that became popular or trendy in different periods that arose, who knows where, different cities, different places. And some had some wonderful names. And now I'd like to hand this over to lovely Ramona Staffeld, and she's going to tell us about a couple of other videos we have.
Well, good evening, everyone. Can you all hear me? Cool, I'm doing a little different today. So nice to be together again. Thank you so much. As Thomas has already worded you up on, there was an animal dance craze in the early 1900s. And I found an article that cited a newspaper clipping from 1909, where a bellboy was arrested for doing, I gotta make sure I get this right. He was doing the turkey trot. Now, you had the bunny hug and the turkey trot and the grizzly bear and the buzzard lope. And there was also the kangaroo dip and the flock squeeze. I mean, it was really, really a craze. but it was a quite shocking for society, for mainstream culture, for people to be very close. Publicly, of course. And in fact, there was one of the inaugural ball for Woodrow Wilson's presidency in 1913 was apparently canceled because of the possibility of an animal dance scandal.
Were all the different dances as risque, do you think, in the public eye, like considered as naughty, or only some of them?
Oh, no, all. All as far as I can tell. And I think what I found so interesting is the power of the human body and the need to control it ultimately, and what dance is. And I found some interesting quotes actually that I wanted to share with you quickly, I thought were just fascinating. Dance has long been targeted by people who have sought to exert control, says Sarah Kaufman, dance critic at the Washington Post, because it's all about the body and it's a supreme power to control what people can do with their bodies. And I thought that was on point. And then I'll also read to you something from Social Dance, a book from 1924. The boll weevil wiggle, the Texas Tommy wiggle are danced in close personal contact intended to arouse sex feelings. The grizzly bear encourage the closest and the most violent physical contact for the same purpose. The bunny hug is danced in imitation of the sex relation between male and female rabbits. The turkey trot, fox trot, horse trot, fish walk, dog walk, tiger dance, and the buzzard lope are all imitative of the lower animals in their sex life, sex desires, sex excitement, and sex satisfaction. And these things are in the minds of the dancers who understand the meaning of the animal dance. Mm. So this is from 1924. But I think what is really hard to grasp is how risque, how naughty this really, really was. But also to when we watch these clips, one thing to note is that the music is not the music that was played. It was dubbed over, put on afterwards. And it would usually be kind of a ragtime thing. A young Irving Berlin actually wrote a song called The Grizzly Bear. So it was just everywhere. It was in popular culture. Yes, there's story after story of public officials and Catholic priests and all kinds of people coming out and you know, basically prohibiting things. Lots of dance hall proprietors were fined, people were arrested, like it was a big deal. Mm-hmm. And actually dance prohibition in general was threatened, was very, very, there were some folks who were pretty eager to try to make that happen.
Scary, hey? Maybe because it was often tied also with alcohol consumption and gambling in a lot of these venues, I'd say.
Absolutely.
But yes, imagine banning dancing.
Absolutely. Just before I watch the clip, I wanted to finish with this lovely quote. It's so beautiful. As dance critic Sarah Kaufman points out, various religious groups have tried to put a stop to dancing along the line. She says, this is the same person says, that the joy that dancing brings about and the transcendent feeling of being swept up into something out of the ordinary is what scares control freaks. Look at the Jim Crow South, where blacks and whites were kept apart during early Motortown review tours in the 1960s. The fear was that people might start dancing together and gosh, forget their differences. So this is powerful stuff. This is where it's at, you guys. This is it. Let's watch these clips. Thank you again for giving me a moment to share with you. And of course, if you have questions or more curiosities around all of this, there's plenty of things to find on the internet.
Yeah, and just so everyone knows, Ramona only just made it. She had to juggle a small child getting to bed. So thank you, Ramona.
Oh, no worries. Also, the clip of the grizzly bears from France in 1913, and the other clip is from it's believed somewhere in San Francisco at a black dance hall in 1910. And you will see the Texas Tommy, which if you do the Lindy Hop, you will have done this movement with the hand behind the back. And it's quite exciting to see that. And of course, Thomas has been talking about Aboriginal and traditional dances from Africa, and you can clearly see that cultural meaning and the rhythm and this language that is ancient. And then you can also see this European influence of, well, you get the idea. And then if we jump around to some swing dancing clips in the future, you can put some of these pieces together. So hit it, Tommy. how good is that? What was I going to comment on? Well, oh, I also read that the grizzly bear was mimicking a dancing bear, which is also a whole other topic, and super not cool, but it was a thing, especially when, you know, shows would travel from town to town. But I believe that, but they, you know, they were kind of strutting around. Oh, did you see that jacket sweep? If you need to go back and watch the first video, and it happens a few times with some of the leaders, they're sweeping there, the people wearing jackets. What else? I think there's a ball and a jack moment in that clip as well. Thomas?
Yo.
That was fun. Thanks everybody. You'll also at some point want to watch after Zeben, which is a clip with Shorty George Snowden and his partner, and he does a wonderful Texas Tommy, and that's in 1929, so not too far along in history.
Well, thanks, Marla. Thanks for sharing.
Anytime. My pleasure.
Yeah, I think it's great to see these other styles of dance, I think, because they were all contemporary to each other and were very much all happening at once. And there was a lot of crossover and maybe not always distinction. People were kind of mixing and matching. And I think a huge reason for this was probably the minstrel circuits, or also these traveling shows, variety shows in vaudeville, which came a little bit later in the theaters. But people would create acts either solo with duo, trio, four people was very common as well. And you'd kind of just put something together as entertaining as you could make it. And this often involved a bit of everything. And most of these entertainers were good at so many things. I mean, could play an instrument very well, could do flips and all kinds of acrobatics into the splits very often. Could tap dance, could like move their bodies, could sing, and it was just considered kind of prerequisite to going on these tours and to be successful at this, because of course there was a lot of competition as well. But I love to see these older dances that have very quite distinct forms, because I feel nowadays in the way, especially with tap dance, at least it seems to me like very almost homogenous, and I think a huge part of this is things like the internet and ease of travel, but it's interesting to see when things, well, they had a lot clearer shape to them, as it seems most folk dancers have also like some quite strict parameters, I want to say, on like how you move your body or how you relate to the music, that gives it quite a very particular flavor, which is, yeah, it starts to mix and match, and I think it's how we got to where we are with how things are dancing now, with just like huge breadth of influences from all over the world. I mean, even now you could say jazz is influenced by musics and cultures all over the world. It's no longer of one particular variety. But jazz changed a lot also. I really loved Mesmer's Rowe's book for this, called Really the Blues, which is wonderful. He just talks a lot about jazz's transition from New Orleans, moving up to Chicago, moving to New York in the early 1900s. And how it really changed things, because I think New Orleans was another story compared to the rest of the states. There were independent movements, I think, of different kinds of musics growing up, but New Orleans just had such a powerful flavor to it that I think influenced hugely the music that was to come later, very soon after in New York. Yes. With that being said, I'm wary of the time. I had a feeling this would happen again. Goodness me. I'm 2 pages into 4. So there may be a part 2 to this early tap dance again. Let's maybe watch a couple more before we finish, because there's a lot. Oi, oi, oi. there was a dancer who, another one that I absolutely love, her name is Harriete Quicksand Brown. And she was well known on the vaudeville circuit as a sand dancer, which was probably also another of these dances that was around before tap dance was tap dance. And it was just a way for people to make rhythms with their feet on different kinds of surfaces, which very often happened to be just who knows where, in your backyard or on the porch with some friends. But it very quickly evolved and people became quite, had a lot of finesse doing this. And there was a handful of people who became very skilled at this, I think in the, we're probably talking early 1900s, but not so many people dived into this. I think most dancers could do what you call sand dance, but there were a few who really explored it. But Harriete Brown was one who did, and she carried with her a box that would fold out and she could put sand in it and dance and somehow be heard over the band. I've got no idea how that worked. But yeah, there's another sand dancer who many of us have maybe heard of called Sandman Sims, who was also a tap dancer. But apparently Harriete Brown used to talk a little bit of trash about him because she said he dabbled in, but she put him through his money. But unfortunately, as was the case, very often the men overshadowed the women, just in terms of performance opportunities and being offered jobs, because women were expected to be chorus line dancers or other kinds of eccentric dancers, having a solo act in what was considered a men's role in public on the stage. In private, I'm sure all kinds of things went on, but yes. But this is why it's so exciting also, I think, to see Harriete Brown dance. So let's check her out. This is from quite a bit later. Where are we? I don't know when this would have been. It looks like maybe the 70s even. I can say. Well, enjoy. Here we go. Harriete Quicksand Brown. Harriete Brown. I love this as well. There's not many people these days doing sand dance either. Really, maybe only one or two. There's Guillem Alonso in Barcelona, who runs a wonderful dance school at Grants too, called Escola Luthier, which maybe has, it's a full-time dance program in Europe, tap dance program, but they do many things inside of this, but he has beautiful, beautiful studios, which I was lucky to work at for about a year. And he is wonderful at the sand dance, but one of few who I know. Also Heather Cornell in New York, beautiful lady who worked back in the day quite a bit with Charles Cookie Cook and Eddie Brown also. And later ran one of the most popular tap dance companies, which was called Manhattan Tap. But yes, not so much sand dancing happening nowadays, but a fun thing to try. I found a good little sneaky spot at the beach near me the other day, which was perfect, on the concrete with some sand on top. But this perhaps brings us to the end of this evening. So thank you again for coming. Wonderful to see you here. Hope you've enjoyed. I know this one's a bit, we're getting into some nerdy stuff with these older videos, but yeah, I hope you enjoy. We'll, I think, continue in 2 weeks, part two of this, because there's still quite a handful of things more. Thank you again, Ramona 1929, for hosting us. Thank you everyone here for coming. If you wish, there's a link to donate on the Facebook site. Please follow and you'll get all the notifications and this stuff. I don't know how Facebook works anymore. But yeah, before we go, let's watch, I found this one video very recently that I could not believe this. There's a dancer named Arthur Duncan, who maybe we'll watch doing his regular dancing another time. Because in this, you won't see his face, but he was one of the few dancers in the 60s and 70s who were working constantly, because he was on a television special called The Lawrence Welk Show that was maybe a weekly show, and he'd appeared every week for about 10 years doing a tap dance, a new tap dance number. So he was very lucky for his, as far as tap dances go, but this was one of his acts on The Lawrence Welk Show. So I'll play this and say good evening and see you all soon. Please enjoy.
It's the Lawrence Welk Show.
Now we're going to take you to outer space for a few giant steps by our flying king of taps, Arthur Duncan. Thank you.